Greetings, New Zealand naturopath Eric Bakker, author of Candida Crusher. Thanks for joining me again in another video in our Helicobacter Pylori series. I'm going to be talking about the signs and symptoms of a HP infection. So I've got my laptop open here. I'm looking at my ericbakker.com website. I've got an article on there called Heartburn, which is all about H. pylori, which is one of the chief symptoms. Now, the interesting thing about Helicobacter is it doesn't produce exactly the same symptomatology in every single patient. Some people develop gastric ulceration, duodenal or gastric ulcers. So the duodenal ulcer is further down the stomach. The gastric ulcer is a bit higher up. Dr. Robin Warren, the chief pathologist who did a huge amount of research on Helicobacter in the early days, believed that 10 to 15% of all people who get HP infection will go on to develop ulceration. Now think about that for a minute, 10 to 15%. 10 to 15% is a lot when you think about how many millions of people in the US are infected in other countries with this particular bug. If you think that the drug called Nexium, the acid blocker, in 2014 sold for, I think they sold $6.4 billion. So it makes me wonder how many of those billions of dollars are actually, you know, treating people with Helicobacter that shouldn't even be on this blasted drug in the first place. Anyway, I'm straying from the point like I usually do. So the signs and symptoms are varied. It depends if your body is, you know, if the bacteria is stimulating overproduction, and in some cases, for reasons we don't really understand, it actually switch off production. And the patient can develop achlorhydria or an absence of stomach acid. In other people, it can just mess the whole lot up. So it can either overproduce or underproduce or mess up the digestion. And that's why the symptoms can be varied from patient to patient. But I'm going to read out a list of the typical signs and symptoms of a Helicobacter pylori infection. Nausea or queasiness, a low-grade feeling of queasiness, feeling a little bit sick. Some patients can get really sick and actually vomit at times, or vomit for no reason at all, which is, you know, an unusual thing, but it can be linked to it. Avoidance of chili, garlic, or a specific food which does not agree with the tummy. So it could be Uncle Fred coming over or Grandpa who says, I can't eat them potatoes. Every time I eat them potatoes, I feel sick. I don't like garlic. Every time I have a piece of garlic, I feel like crap. I'm burping and I'm sick and everything. So if the person feels ill quite quickly after eating a certain food, it may be a problem there with Helicobacter pylori. Bloating, worse after meals. Feeling worse after meals or certain kinds of foods. Recurring abdominal pain, intestinal cramps, that's a big one. So this pain of Helicobacter can make you think that you're having a heart attack. Because if you think where the stomach is and where the heart is, they're very sort of close together, okay? And many people, in fact, who end up in the emergency room or get the ambulance around are having indigestion or could have a serious HP attack rather than a heart attack. So, and it can be quite a sharp pain. You can actually think you're dying sometimes, so the pain can be that intense. I've had many patients over the years tell me they ended up in the emergency ward and the doctor said, you've got heartburn, go home. Take this antacid, you'll be fine. There's nothing wrong with your heart. We checked your blood out, you did an ECG, everything's clear, just go home. Peptic or duodenal ulcers, which we've spoken about already in this series, over 90% of all cases of peptic and duodenal ulcer are caused by Helicobacter pylori. In rare cases, you can actually have a small tumour in the stomach producing acid, but those are really rare cases. Burping, which can be pretty bad. You might have a relation that's got actually a reputation for burping. Okay, some people can burp the alphabet. I think I actually saw that in one of those Guinness Book of Records. So, you know, if the burping's excessive, really over the top, it could well be Helicobacter. Remember what we said, it can produce an over-acidity and also an under-acidity, so food can sit there like a rock. It's not being digested properly. You can feel like you swallowed a brick. It can be sitting there. Heartburn, maybe reliant on Gaviscon or Losec or Tums or some kind of antacid drink or a pill. You know, if the person's always got a packet of candy, sweets or something in their pocket, pop in their mouth because of heartburn, this is the sort of patient I'm looking for. He's probably got Helicobacter. The person always wants mints. You know, I had a friend like that. Always wanted to buy mints all the time, so because it made him feel better. He didn't know why, but he felt better. So those are the sort of key things I look for. Diarrhea or constipation after several years of infection. Well, is it any wonder if the stomach's going to play out sooner or later? what happens downstream is going to be all affected as well. So it's not no wonder why, you know. Disturbed sleep, maybe waking up with a hollow feeling or heartburn. You know, these people can sometimes wake up really early in the morning being really hungry and having to eat food. I've also found at times that some patients have got issues with their position, so they feel better for sort of semi-reclining, or they feel better in those chairs. You know, you can, they've got the footrest that goes up, they feel way better like that. Other people feel better propped up. Some people have a couple of bricks under the head of the bed to prop the bed up a little bit. So other people don't have that at all. But if I, as soon as I hear people talking about this positional problem with gastric discomfort, Helicobacter. Now, when you think about it, if the stomach, if you got acid in here and it's moving around a bit, you know, it could affect the symptoms of that person quite a lot. Now, here's an interesting one that many people don't think about, vitamin B12 deficiency. If you've had a problem with your stomach for a long time, there may be an issue with what we call the parietal cells. So these are cells that produce a hormone called the intrinsic factor. Now that binds to vitamin B12, which is found in chiefly in animal sources. So intrinsic factor binds to B12. It's produced by this particular cell, or parietal cell. It goes down to the small intestine, and there's a small area there it gets absorbed. Now if the stomach's playing up, not working properly, there is a chance that the B12 is not really efficiently being utilized with the intrinsic factor. So I always recommend people with a stomach problem of long duration always get vitamin B12 checked. Because people with Helicobacter, I've spoken with some specialists on my trips to Australia at some of these big conferences, say they've even seen it linked with serious depression and anxiety disorder. Well, if you've got no B12 in the body and it's never checked, you can have serious anxiety disorder and major depression if the stomach is playing out. And of course, your doctor may refer you to a psychiatrist thinking that you're all nuts, you know, but get your B12 checked, because B12 is important for another biochemical reaction we call methylation, which we haven't got time to go into today. Just check out methylation. Altered appetite. Sometimes you feel like eating, sometimes you don't feel like eating. After being infected for many years, you may have developed deficiencies which can lead to a whole lot of health problems. Well, if the stomach's not working efficiently, how the hell can you ever break down and absorb and utilize nutrition from your diet? I don't care how good your diet is. I don't care how biodynamic it is, or how GM-free, or how perfect it's grown. If the stomach is not working efficiently, you're completely wasting your time with the best foods. So you need to have a stomach in very good condition to utilize the nutrition properly. You know, give it to the end target, to all the cells of the body. Helicobacter is implicated in Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So there's actually a link there with Hashimoto's patients and H. pylori. So if you have got Hashimoto's and you're watching this, I think it may pay for you to do a fecal, like a stool test, and maybe a serum antigen test, just to make sure you haven't got HP. 40% of migraine headache sufferers are positive with HP, and eradication subsides the headaches in a lot of cases. So if you suffer from recurring migraines, get checked for Helicobacter. Acne rosacea. I don't know how many patients I've seen with acne rosacea over the years. Helicobacter pylori is suspected of causing acne rosacea, and eradication of HP often results in a significant reduction of these symptoms. So have a think about those signs and symptoms, but the key one is burping, heartburn, tired, fatigue, not feeling well, funny diet, or what we call a dodgy diet or strange, like some foods you know, you can't tolerate, some foods you can, or if people find you what we call a fussy eater or a finicky sort of eater. Now look carefully for these in children as well, especially if children don't like foods or argue with you they can't eat this or they can't eat that, they may have a problem. In Europe, this problem is so big, they've got the European Foundation, Helicobacter Foundation. They've actually set up a whole institution just to study this in children. So bad is the problem. Countries like Spain, Portugal, they've got a major problem with HP. So think about those signs and symptoms. And if you're unsure about them, check with your healthcare professional. Thanks for tuning in.